KBLKRadio.com. Everybody give it up.
All right, DJ.
How's it going, everybody?
All right, thanks for coming in, man.
Morning, morning.
DJ, I know you remember me, man, from the camp.
Oh, yeah.
No, I can't get that. You never let him forget.
Yeah, man. I mean, I know I'm Puerto Rican, man, but I stole his watch accidentally.
I do remember that.
He told me to hold it for him while he was giving instruction on the whole line.
He didn't tell you to take it home.
Yeah.
I forgot about it.
Yeah.
I was wondering why my pants were sagging so much. That thing was so heavy. Besides, you know, I'm all gut, no butt. You know, my pants fall down anyway. But it was falling down even further, and I reached down and I felt this big giant apparatus. And how much was that worth? About $10.
Man, hey, probably about $10.
Oh no,
man, flea market, man. We're hopping a little bit.
Man, and also that day it was a Larry English camp.
Yeah,
Iggy was there, and so he was giving demonstrations the whole line, and that was like the dummy, you know?
Oh, yeah.
So he hit me with a forearm shiver, man. I felt it for like 3 weeks afterwards.
Dang.
He hit me so hard, my heart stopped. I was like, ugh. And I had to stand there and take it, man, because he was giving us a great instruction.
I don't know if you took it.
No.
I mean, you're a big guy, too.
So DJ means destroying the joint, right?
Sometimes.
Yeah. You ain't no gentle giant out there, brother. I know.
Nah, not on the field now. Phil is a whole different person.
Now, my man, you from the 9th Ward in New Orleans?
Yeah.
And you left there, like, right before, like, Katrina?
Yeah, we probably left, a little bit before, probably in the morning, early in the morning, left there. And I'm really happy that we did it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So after that, you went to Mississippi, or?
We got stuck in Mississippi for a little bit, trying to get over, and eventually got to Mobile, Alabama, with some of my relatives.
Okay. So tell me about your high school experience. Like, where'd you go?
I've been everywhere a little bit. well, at first, before Katrina D here, I was going to McDonald's 35 in New Orleans during the summertime. And at the time, it was Coach Reed and Coach Dyers, and mm-hmm. my coaches at the time. And I was working out with them there and everything. And then the storm hit. I was like, man, so where I'm going?
Yeah.
So we ended up going to Mobile, Alabama, and going to high school down there and go to McGill.
Okay.
McGill Tooling down in Mobile, Alabama, and going there for like 2 years, and ended up transferring, going to Mississippi, playing Mississippi, playing at Bluxton High School down there. And ever since then, I transferred back to Foley High School in Alabama. So I was traveling the whole time, and part of that time, I was humbled like during that time too, with my family. But we made it through. I ended up playing at the University of Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And going there, I was number one recruit in the country. I had a scholarship. My boys, we would carry bags.
Yeah.
we were going to the lunch table, and everybody would look like, what is he doing? You know? And it was like, he had scholarship letters like from all the schools and everything.
Those were all letters.
Carry lunch bags. Like full of scholarships.
Oh, man.
It was crazy. They even had JUCOs to write me, you know, because sometimes some players don't make because of the grades.
Grade,
that wasn't the case. I had a mindset of going in there. I didn't get the thing done.
Yeah.
Go to college, get my degree. And that's what I did. Graduated 3 years and a half.
Wow.
I'm a degree. I was tell kids about the school, like marry school.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You committed to it, you know. And what I mean by that is going in and asking questions. How can you help me here? If I got a weakness here in a certain subject,
mm-hmm.
ask questions about it.
Right? Exactly.
You know, because some of us are not book smart. So
right.
Some of us need a little bit of help.
Ain't nothing wrong with asking.
Nothing wrong with asking because if you don't ask, then you're just gonna be like everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked. I want to know, how can I help? How can you help me? Mm-hmm. How can I be successful? And that was my mindset going to college. How good can I really be?
Yeah.
Besides just being a football player,
right.
You know, everybody can be a football player. But see, the thing about me is, I want to be great.
Yeah.
Because anybody can be good. Anybody can be good, but the person that want to be great as a player and as a student. You know, they go a whole long way,
and
they put on like a higher standard.
Yeah,
you know, I talk about a mindset. I was talking about mindset on Instagram, Twitter, everything, because everything you wake up, you have to think about, like, I have to get better today, right. No matter what it is. And that's how I approached college and going to Alabama, had that winning tradition, you know, that made me even more hungry.
Yeah.
So you attacked your academics. You didn't shy away from it.
That's it. I know people will go around obstacles, but some, I go through obstacles. I mean, you got to.
Yeah. So the test, you were scared of the test, the SAT.
Oh, I sat in the front. I sat in the front of class.
Come on with it.
Bring it. That's how I felt about it.
That's bring awesome. It. So now, how many, I mean, you must have had like 50, 60, 100 offers, right?
Yeah, I offered from USC, UCLA, Texas, Ohio State, Florida, I had every SEC school, I had almost, the Pac-12, I had all of that, I had Penn State come after me, I had a lot of colleges,
wow.
like after me, but when I committed to Alabama, it was like, at the time, Coach Shula was there, and Coach Samuel was at Miami. And I didn't know he was coming or not, so I was like, all right, if he's still there, I kept my commitment. I was the first player to commit, like, in my class. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to stick with it. I mean, even though you had LSU coming at me, because, you know, And Coach Simon, you know, he's a great coach. You know, that's my great, a great coach as well. But, you know, they all have the same identity,
yeah.
Same mindset, going there, winning games, going there by like academics and stuff like that, you know. And because I kind of won it for him because he won a championship in 03,
yeah,
with LSU,
right?
And that's my 1-1 in 07, so it was kind of like,
you know, either way,
I mean, either way,
yeah.
But I know Coach Saban had a winning mindset, you know, being at Michigan State, you know, coaching there for a little bit. He even had Antonio Gates coming there. All the time to play basketball and football, but I don't know how that worked out. But I heard a little bit of story about it.
I want to keep that.
So, what was the? Did you take all five official visits, or?
I took a few visits. I went to LSU a couple times, and I went to Bama, and then I went to Auburn. I thought about Auburn, I was like, I could go here, but it's too small.
Yeah,
too small.
Wow, really?
But I mean, I had other offers to go to USC, but I didn't take it. So I ended up staying outside because I was kind of like, if I go far away from home, then nobody gonna see me play.
Yeah.
Right. So I was like, I'm close. I'm in Alabama. I can go ahead and play.
That's my family right? Close by.
Yeah, they're close by. I was like, you know what? This might be home.
Yeah.
Now, how does it feel to line up in a national championship game? I mean, for us who don't. Very unsuccessful people here.
Yeah. The only time I lined up for a national championship game was for tickets. That was it.
I mean, we even that feeling of being in all the lights and people.
I mean, in a certain fashion, you gotta act like you've been there before.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I mean. I went there 09 championship. I was redshirted during that time. The following year, it'll make my first start. Still got three rings, though. I still got a chain. Still put in good work because everybody know it.
Right.
You know, and then I, you know, playing in the title championship game in 11, 12. We won back-to-back championships.
Wow.
Played LSU. LSU beat us at home. My redshirt sophomore year, we didn't beat them in the championship. Right. First time SEC school played another SEC school in the championship.
Championship.
It was crazy. They were charged up.
So you were a D lineman first.
Yeah.
And then you moved to the O line. Like you're in a championship game and you're going against these monsters and you just handle these fools.
He dominated. Playing tackle at the point in time, playing on right tackle. Alabama. I mean it was a task. Well, I mean, I'm talking against guys like Marcus Mingo played LSU. Right. And you got Sam Montgomery, who with Houston, Texas.
Uh-huh.
And then you had Brockers from the Rams. Wow. So I'm playing against first round draft picks right here. And we all going at it. And the thing about it is, we all played together in high school. I played against Mingo in high school at the Army game.
Oh,
and wow. I was like, and then in a meeting with my other teammate here in the Chargers, Chris Watt. That plays out there again. I played there. We all met each other again. You know? But playing in that championship game, you know, I go back to the championship game. I know everybody want to hear about it. But yeah, we had to go in there and make them quit.
Yeah.
That was our mindset, going there and make them quit. I mean, it was a good game. Physical fight. I mean, they put up a good fight, but we had better talent. You know.
Wow. Man. So, now, you're playing O-line and switch from D-line. Is O-line your favorite or D-line?
You know, if I was 316, I could take deep. that's where I can run with them. Yeah. But I mean, playing on the offensive line, you know, it's a lot better in body. You know, you're not too dinged up, and plus you can play a whole lot longer.
Yeah.
I mean, you seen who that
Jackie Slater.
Jackie Slater.
About 20 years.
20 years in the league. Bruce Matthews.
Yeah.
That guy.
Oh man.
I mean, you see guys out there like, man, if they can do it, I know I can.
Anthony Munoz, man.
And the Munoz Bengals.
Yep.
Oh, Walter Jones played by doing it. Yeah, Seattle Seahawks. You know, guys like that, so you're like, they put in their time and effort.
They're starting to get their due now. I mean, they're starting to get paid like they should be.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you can't win a game without an O-line.
Oh, you definitely can.
Right now.
So far.
Edgar, what kind of athlete you got?
You went from D-line to O-line, you know. Tackle, now guard. How was the transition from tackle to guard? You know, from being outside, you know, to now protected from the inside.
It's just 12 inches over.
I mean, it's a little bit faster on the inside. I mean, things have a lot more quicker guy on when you are a whole lot faster. I mean, you got some big guys, some heavy, heavy guys. You think you big, but they big. And so sometimes you have a little 6'2" short, stubby guy that like a little stomp in the ground. They don't want to move. You're like, God, come on. Give him a little ground or something, you know? Shoot. But, using tackle is kind of for the pretty boys. I was like, man, I'm a grinder. I like to be accurate. I still look good when I'm doing it. You feel me?
The Burberry still.
I gotta remind people that I'm the bear in the woods. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, but playing guard, I mean, it's a lot more physical down there. I mean, guys are awesome nimble guys down there.
Yeah.
There's some nimble guys I call them sweet feet guys down there. Yeah, they got good feet, they wanna get by. And sometimes some cats that play D-line, they don't know the contact with you. They know the swim moves. You know? And they hit that contract, that big bite on them, you know?
Yeah, they leave it.
Yeah, exactly.
So, this mindset, your attitude, I love it. I mean, who do you attribute that to? Your grandma? Your mom? Your grandma used to hit you with that pain, you know?
Oh, man. just from that standpoint, you know, I always had that type of, I'm still a kid sometimes when I play a football game.
Right.
I mean, like everybody said, we play a kid's game, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I enjoy it. Mm-hmm. But playing in high school, you know, I always had the mindset of being the best, trying to be like everybody. I didn't care if you play receiver, I want to outrun you.
Yeah.
You know, and that was my mindset. Growing up, I started growing.
Yeah.
You know, and it didn't change. Just I changed positions.
Yeah.
You know, but everybody's like, for instance, like I know that every great leader was once a follower. You know, you can't go be a born leader. Sometimes people have to learn to be led first, and then break off and become their own leader. Right. And that's why I had to learn. Like I'm a leader, and I didn't know it because I was listening to other guys lead. You know, and I sit back and I observe them and I learn from them. You know, but sometimes it comes to a point that sometimes leaders know how to lead when things go wrong either.
Yeah.
So you can't be a sometime leader. You gotta be a leader when things are going bad, things are going good. You have to be on it.
Yeah.
You know, and that's me. I'm gonna be a leader when things are going wrong, things are going good. You know, and see, this is what it takes though. No man is an island. He must draw his strength from others. Nice. So for me, I need my team behind me.
Yeah.
So if I go into a street fight, they behind me.
Yeah.
That's my gang right there. They with me. Yeah. They got my back.
Yep.
So we see me, you see three. You know what I'm saying? I'm not by myself.
I see you by yourself, though. I'm out of there. You ain't got to be nobody else. Right. Exactly. Just a low one.
I don't want to see three.
Yeah. So three, I'm on a plane, boy.
Hey, you know what? I feel as though that if my teammate is willing to get everything he got for me, I'm going to do the same thing for him. That's why we go out there and put a long drive because everybody working together. Yeah. You know, and we had that mindset of not being a nine. I always say, don't be the nine. Because I mean it. I mean, I'm going to go in there and give you everything I got. And plus, you're going to feel me.
Yeah.
I may lose a battle here and there. But best believe, you're going to feel me. Yeah. I promise you.
So you say you still have fun out there.
I still have fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Man, I'm slowly getting the guard thing down. But when I get it down, it's over with.
Yeah.
I'm ready. Right. You won't stop me. Right. And that's how I feel, I feel about it. Every Sunday I step on that field, I give a little prayer to God. You know, thank you for giving the opportunity. But after that, I go out there and let it go. Now, what happens on that field, we'll sit on that field now. It is what it is. Just know, it's just for the people on the field. Not for the people. And I know some people are like, wow, I ain't know he was that type of guy. He's like, he's not me in that shirt. Anything that goes on the field, boy, off the field, I'm a nice guy. You know, I'll speak to you and say, hey, you know. After that, you know, on the field, man, it's game over. Yeah. You can't go to jail on the field. Yeah. You got to find the field. It's all legal.
Yeah.
It's all legal.
Yeah. Legalized ass whooping.
It's empty. You might get fined for it. You know, at the end of the day, you can't go to jail or whatever.
Yeah. Speaking of off the field, I met you about 2 years ago, your rookie year.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how you came to one of our events, but... You know, you were a very humble guy. You know, I was giving out my, you know, doing my whole clothing thing, and that I'm still doing. And I just, you know, hey, will you wear this ducky shirt? And you grabbed a shirt, and you even grabbed a beanie.
That's a beanie. I remember that.
I like this.
We're gonna take it back,
right? No. I was like, hey, can you get ready to shirt? He's like, oh yeah, I like this. I like that. You know, you was cool, and you immediately put it on. You know, and I was just like, you know, that really was cool because, you know, I was trying to get, you know, my thing out there, and, you know, me and my boys, and, you know, you came into town not knowing, you know, not knowing anybody or anything like that, and you put it on, you rocking, you know, to this day, I got your package for you, too. I got you.
Spaghetti strap shirt.
you was cool, you know, and then, you know, when I see you, you know, out there on, you know, practice field, whatever, you know, you speak to me, and you know, and I really thank you for that, because not a lot of people, you know, are like that once they get to that level, you know. Yeah. I always, you know, I meet people who come in, you know, from their rookie year, and they don't know nobody, and they just, you know, they're all cool and humble, but then once they make it, and, right. You know, and they at that level, you know, you're already 2 years in, you know, and, you know, and you the man, you know, everybody know you around town for sure, you know, as soon as you walk in the door, everybody know you, you know, and when you see me, you know, you just like, hey, what's going on? You know, can I get a hat? Can I get a shirt? You know, and it's cool, you know, and I really, you know, thank you for being such a humble guy. You know, you're a big guy, and when somebody look at you, it's like, you're mean, you know what I'm saying? I was like, nah, man, that's a blue girl, right?
So sweet guys behind him.
Not too sweet.
Not too sweet.
So Fluke, now, in your spare time, my man, I mean, you sit down and watch TV, you play the chicken, or you watch Love and Hip Hop. What do you like to play? You know, what's your free time?
I'm a gamer. I hate to say it, but I mean, because half the time, I don't like going out too much.
Yeah.
Because if I go out, I mean, it'll go either go get stopped.
Right.
You know, things I have, I'm like, oh, like, sometimes it can be a hazard. So I remember going to get dinner, and so I stopped me in the middle of my dinner, like, can you take a picture with me? I'm like, I'm eating.
Yeah.
When I get done, I had some fried chicken in front of me. You know, I'm going to stop. They don't even know it. Hey, I have the grease for my feet, and the hot sauce still on. I want to stop, like, give me about 10 minutes, I'm going to come back to you. But, I mean, I took the picture, though, you know.
Yeah.
And, but, you know, sometimes, it can be a headache sometimes, but you have to learn that. If they were in your spot, you know,
They'll
be thankful for it too. So I mean, I'm grateful.
Yeah.
I can't complain.
Yeah,
you know,
as long as you're not rude about it.
Exactly.
Disrespectful. Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, I have some people like that. Like on fan day, you know, some people say a word because I can't stay out there that long.
Right.
It's an autograph. Right. If I gotta get in.
Yeah.
You know, but it's okay. I mean, I would tell them, hey, have the best day.
Yeah.
All I can tell
you.
Yeah.
So, music and. Free time with
music. Nah, I listen to New Bill. I mean, Drake, even though I know Drake and New Bill went at
it. Hey, still good.
I mean, it's still good. I love both of them. I think they're great artists. You know, I listen a little bit of R&B sometimes. a little Al Green.
Yeah.
You know, a little bit. And, I listen to music sometimes. I'm in the community. I mean, I'm free, I go to, like, off day, like, during the season, I go to the juvenile detention center.
Uh-huh.
Over there, and,
Curtin Mason.
Wow, so, I go there, and those kids, like, every off day on Tuesday, you know. And I remember last year, I bought the kids, like, pizza on New Year's, like.
That's great.
What about the whole staff, from the kids to the staff on down, you know, and I got a couple awards for it, gang awareness, and got a award from Dick Lewis. I know everybody know Dick Lewis, and everything. He set it up for me, and after that, we just took off.
Man, so you're not just out there whipping ass on the field, you're out there inspiring people in the community.
Exactly. I mean, you gotta give kids hope, you know. It's about going there and telling them, hey, no matter how hard it is, you can make it.
Yeah, right.
You can do it.
Yeah.
You know, because I tell kids, like, hey, like, anybody can go out there and just say, it's too hard, you know, right. I can't do it. But if you go in there every day and say, I can do it, look in the mirror and tell you that, because you can do it, you're going to accomplish it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, like, the tough times that you had, like the Katrina and the homelessness and moving here and there, that made you tougher, but you still had hope, you still had vision.
Yeah, it's about having, you got to have vision. If you don't have vision, you just lost. Mm-hmm. Right. You know, like, faith without works, it's hopeless. Mm-hmm. You know, but I had people around me, and they were putting my circuit to help me, like, from the coaches, like, helping me out, from the teachers staying after school with me, mm-hmm. to help me on my schoolwork. And I appreciate all of them, because they help. They're a part of me. You know, so when I go back to high school, I go back to my coaches and see them, I'm like, thank you so much for giving a kid out of so many opportunities, because some of us miss it. Because we too caught up with our friends doing the wrong thing, mm-hmm. trying to do the right thing, and that's how we miss it. And they took the time on me for days, sitting on weekends, going to work. They found me another job to go work at to make money off my family. So I appreciate every little thing that I have. And I'm grateful for it. I mean, now it's like, whoa, I got all this. Like, it still hasn't sunk in that, hey, you this guy, you're a ball player, you're NFL, you got business and all. But to me, I'm just DJ.
Yeah,
I'm still me.
Yeah,
you know, the money don't change nobody.
It changes
the people around you. But for me, I'm not going to change for nobody. I'm going to stay the same person I've been, caring, giving. Mm-hmm. Somebody need help with, I'm going to go help them out. You know, and that's me.
Man, that's great. So now on Sunday, you're in the huddle. What is the favorite play that they call? Oh man, this is it. It's on.
If we can get a one-on-one block all day with one person, I'll tell you. I know I'm gonna do my job. Running to the right, I'll tell you all day. We got it done.
Nice.
Done deal.
Any play with a one-on-one.
Any play one-on-one. I'm ready. That's how I feel about it. Either play.
So that's your advice to any old lineman, like
any old lineman. Take your head on. Like the Bible says, Psalm 27 says, the Lord is my light, whom shall I fear? I fear no man. No man on that field can't stop me.
Right.
Only the other person can stop me is me. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, I don't want to fear. I fear nobody on that field. I don't care who it is in front of me.
Right.
You can't stop my job. Stop my drive. Right. And that's how I see it.
Man, that is awesome. These kids, you got to hear this, man.
Oh, man.
This is some good stuff.
So, you were, first round draft pick. Like, how was that feeling, you know, to get that phone call, to be, you know, to...
Did you go to New York?
Yeah, I kind of fought it. I kind of fought it, I ain't gonna lie to you. I didn't want to go. I'll be honest with you, I didn't want to go. I was like, to my agent, like, I don't want to go. Like, this is something I really don't want to go. I just want to stay at home with my family.
Stay with the family, yeah.
And I got my little 4-year-old, so I was like, I just want to stay at home with him, you know, I don't want to go. He's like, come on, you gotta go. It's a great chance. And I looked at myself like, I play right tackle. Like,
yeah.
Come on. All right, come on. I don't play left tackle, but I can play at all. I don't play different positions. Like, it's not hard. Because it's about what, if they didn't even do it, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Right. You told me that if I can go jump off a cliff and land on the the other side, and I'm going to live, I'm going to go do it.
Yeah.
I'll be okay.
Daredevil.
I'll take the risk. Yeah. But at the same time, you know, going there, I was like, I ended up going, though. I ended up going. Yeah. But the hard part was, after that, I was getting my mom to go. And she was struggling with it, so she
didn't want to go.
She had been on the plane a long time. So she was struggling.
Yeah.
So we had to get it right. We had to tell her, look, your baby is going to be on TV. You have to go. You know, and she ended up going. I had a hell of a great time meeting all the players that were going to be drafted. And it was a fun experience for me. I even met up with Shannon Richardson. I played against him in college, too. Yeah. He was in Missouri. Met those guys and, you know, kind of took off from there. I just felt comfortable. Just fell into it. I was just at the draft table, went on that phone call. I was like, I see my teammate go. I see my boy D. Milner go. The Jets. He's going in front of me. I see Chad Wormack. Man, I said, they ain't gonna call, man. I told him, man, I'm not gonna go nowhere. I said, man, I'll be right here. They're the third round guy. I don't know.
Yeah.
But then I get a phone call. I'm like, oh, phone call. I see my phone ring, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm like, who is this? Like, some girl calling me or something. I'm like,
I'm gonna get my number.
Let me change my number later on. But in reality, it was a coach calling me, and I'm looking like, so this number hit on two phones.
Oh,
wow. Now, my phone, my agent phone, too. So I was like,
okay.
Then I see the big phone ringing up. I said, something going on. And I answered the phone, like, hey, you going to be sending it on charger? Like, I was like, San Diego. I really didn't know because I mean, down south, man, we all stick around the south. We hear about California, hear about Compton or going to the Bay Area or stuff like that. But I was like, San Diego, like, man, San Diego, charges away. It's San Diego. You know, and everyone was like, wait, because we all had rolls up, like, San Diego, like, everybody looked like, no, it's California. Oh, shoot.
San Diego.
Everyone was happy. Then he got sad. He was like, you're too far away from home.
And your mom said, where's San Diego?
Yeah, San Diego. I'm shocking, man. I saw the last one. I was like, Mom, I said California. But,
we got to drive now, Mom. I know you ain't flying back.
We get the U-Haul. That was for the But, we were having a great time that night. Flying to San Diego the very next morning after a long night of flying. You know, and
your mom went on that flight too?
No, she actually went home. She went home. She told her she can't come yet.
Shoot. I need a week at least.
At least.
Recover,
before
man.
You come, Mom.
Yeah. At least.
Get settled.
Shoot. But we had a good time. Ended up meeting the coaches there. And after that, we took off from there.
Was there any other teams that were calling before that, or they?
You know, a whole lot of teams were interested.
Yes.
You know, but nobody knew where I was going. Mm-hmm. I thought I was gonna be like a 25th pick, maybe at the bottom, maybe be a Raven or a Saint somewhere. Yeah. That's a team that would call me like, kind of interested. Yeah. So I'm thinking I'll go follow them, but end up going to the Chargers. I guess after that pro day we put on, at Bama, me and Chance, I mean. To the Warman to play for the Titans now. It was a slugfest thing.
So I know that you fear no man, but which one of these NFL D tackles are tough for you?
I mean, I haven't really gone against anybody like give me really too much trouble yet. Okay. You know,
good for Phillip Rivers.
Yeah, during the season, during the season now, the big test is probably like next week and see how it goes. I play against what's his name? Haloti.
Okay.
Haloti. He's big.
Yeah, he's a big boy.
Yeah. Man.
Yeah. You can look him in the eye, sorry.
You get that one action.
Well, look at him though. Yeah. He's a good guy though. He's one of our clients too. For my agent. Oh, okay. So he's a good guy though. Should be fun. Those will do nothing crazy.
Yeah.
So our man Tyrell Williams was here last week, and he had a big play last week. You know, he had that 63-yard little hitch and go, huh?
Yeah, he did a great job.
He's fast.
I caught LJ Johnson. He had a long stride.
We had him in here last week as well. You know, he came in here and did his thing. You know, he came in. I asked him what he done. I ain't gonna lie. You know, me and Coach Iggy, our team is the 49ers. So
here we go.
Hey. But I was driving on 15 freeway and I saw this thing on the side of the road. I looked and it was a 49er hat. I had to pull over so you know.
I hopped out into oncoming traffic to go pick that hat up.
It's brand new.
You brave
soul.
I was definitely rooting for you, you know. I was rooting for you guys. I wanted you guys to do good individually, but this is my team.
I understand that. It's okay.
It was my team.
What team were you coming out with?
When I grew up, I was a Saints fan. That's when I grew up. Right now, I'm a Chargers fan. I play for them, too. So, it worked out. That got me Phil Rivers the first day when I did the NBA come in.
Yeah.
It was like, Phil Rivers? Like, wow, man. You're a big dude. I haven't seen a quarterback that size. He's huge. He's 6'5".
He's kind of got your same attitude. He don't back down from nobody.
He chippy.
Yeah.
He'll get after you.
He'll go out.
I'm like, he was talking trash to Mario Williams. I was like, oh, God. I got to block that guy in that play.
So if he hurts his arm, you could probably line him up a right tackle or something. Yeah. Player two.
Man, it wouldn't matter. It
wouldn't matter.
Shoot.
Go ahead, bro. You got it, man. I was just going to ask, there's a lot of guys who don't want to play like the O-line in high school and everything. They think that position is no fun, no glory. You know, they don't get the respect. They don't understand, man, without that O-line, you got no team. You got some of the best athletes playing O-line. Actually, you got some of the smartest players playing O-line. So, I mean, what kind of advice would you have for a guy coming up who doesn't want to play O-line, but, that's probably the best position for him?
I mean, I'll say beside myself, I looked at Jason Peter.
Mm-hmm.
Jason Peter played Arkansas. And if somebody knew that, he played tight end.
Yeah.
And then he got converted to an offensive lineman.
Mm-hmm.
It was really good. Amazing. Well, he got $100 million third contract. Wow. Another $60 million contract plays left tackle.
Plays left tackle.
I mean, there's money there to be made and playing on the offensive line because there's guys that have a want to be mm-hmm. there, yeah. and some guys that don't want to be there. The guys that don't want to be there are usually the great athletes.
Yeah.
being good at their offensive line. It's fun. It's because of how fun it is to you. I mean, you have like double team block with another guy next to you. Oh. That shit feel good.
Yeah,
double team with one guy. Beat his brakes in.
Right by his safety.
Literally. Hey, I got your number this time. it's fun. I mean, it's a hard job. It's a tough job. Yeah. But people don't say that. Without us, there's no offense.
There's no offense.
I mean, what are you going to play with?
Yeah.
I mean, garbage can buckets.
Well, you guys are right. People don't understand the offensive lineman on the pass play. They got to run backwards, to block a guy. They have to kick backwards and block a monster in front of you. You have to be an athlete.
Yeah, exactly. You got to have great feet, great hands, and people understand that. Often, I know people are like, oh, yeah, bad play. But you got to understand that. Have people that say all that, you could not do our job.
Yeah, right.
If you were great at our job, you'd be doing it.
Yep.
I tell you, you got to understand, some people talk about football, I don't even know about football.
Yeah.
Because some of y'all ain't played it. Yeah. I don't know how you gonna talk about it.
Yeah.
You a spectator. Stay in the lane. Stay there. We do our job pretty good. It's hard. If you review that job, you be like, man, I can't do it. Because you're bringing guys, high talented guys, every week. Every week it's a monster. Yeah. On some part of that D line. And he had that some kind of young, young rookie that coming in. Uh-huh. He want to make a name for himself. Right. So you got to get ready every week.
Yep.
I did play O-line my first 2 years in Pop Warner.
Oh, so you a believer.
Coach Rowland taught me how to launch.
Oh, yeah?
I've been doing this chunky guy since I was young. Yeah, I was there. I was definitely a chunky guy. And then I was like, this is not for me. So I was you know, determined to lose weight and went to linebacker and fullback. So,
okay. Hey, I blame you.
I couldn't do it. I mean, all the power to you guys because I play fullback as well. So, you know, I get a props to you guys for blocking for us. But the trenches is not. It ain't for everybody at all. I couldn't do it at all.
I mean, I don't think we can talk about what happens in the trenches.
They call it in. I told people, mamas, girlfriends.
Oh, man.
You know, we go on Facebook. We talk shit on the field. That's what we do. I mean, people think it's all nice and gay stuff, but it ain't.
And talk about the camaraderie between the other offensive linemen. You know, I mean, you guys are a family within a family right there.
On the offensive line, you got to have that bond. Coach, I always say it's five equals one.
Yeah.
And it's about having that one bond.
Yeah. I think it's making
communication and trust. You got to have that. Yeah, you got to have those things right there. If you don't have those, then you can't be offensive line.
Yeah.
If you don't trust one another, then after that, I mean, you just don't have it.
Yeah, you won't have it
at all.
An offensive line, everybody knows what what the other opposite guard's doing. And
yeah, you got to be able to know to know your calls. If you know your calls, then you kind of lost in the shuffle.
Yeah.
And being at I'll put the offensive line, I mean, it's like we're at the highlights of everything.
Yeah.
Like, we're a big block for a touchdown.
Yeah.
We're in the highlights. We're in the highlights. Oh, he did that.
Yeah.
You know. But I mean, if you don't have a camaraderie between offensive line, just not gonna have a good
offensive line.
It won't happen.
Won't work.
So now from high school to Alabama, the playbook, I mean how difficult is it getting there from Alabama to send the Chargers, the NFL, the
playbook? Playbooking from high school to, man, I was running shotgun in high school, playing offensive line. I'm playing offensive line 1 year in high school. Right. See, most kids been playing since offensive line since Henry. I played offensive line my senior high school.
Wow.
I played D-tackle the whole time. I got converted to offensive line, and then I played left tackle. Mm-hmm. It was easy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think left tackle is a lot easier. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is, but it is. For me, it is. But, Then going there and playing right tackle at Alabama, it was kind of like, I had to swap because I had surgery, shoulder surgery.
Okay.
And I had to swap sides because I can't shoot my left hand. So I had to shoot my right hand and play on my right tackle.
Okay.
Which kind of worked out for me. And then going from the playbook from shotgun to approach to offense was a lot different. So I had to learn power play, I had to learn inside zone, outside zone plays. Right. It was like, whoa. The whole terminology just changed. That was like behind the eight ball. And I was like, man, I ain't ever behind. He said, I'm the dominant guy.
Yeah.
And you go in college, like, I'm the mean, tough guy.
Yeah.
You know, and this guy, like, your size, it kind of like, whoa. I thought I was the biggest kid. I'm 18 years old, looking like, and I gotta find a way to fit in.
Yeah.
Like, now we all equal now. Shoot. Man, feel equal now. Hey, I gotta figure out a way to get better or something. Because as a freshman, you just work all you try to go in there and make a name for yourself.
Yeah.
Got some veterans around, you know, and didn't happen for freshman. It didn't really happen too much. And then finally, I got a little bit stronger.
Uh-huh.
I got a little more leader, got a little more faster. And, started dominating.
Something just clicked, huh?
Just clicked. And then I started getting to the playbook, you know. Started getting to the playbook, and after that, everything was easy.
Yeah.
Then it comes from that, from playing from the SEC ball, and playing inside the NFL, it was like a one-step difference.
Wow.
And the only reason why, because this playbook is the same playbook as ours in college.
Oh.
And the battle for a push offense. So,
nice.
And so we charged. So we got all the same thing.
Yeah.
And it worked out for it.
Terminology.
Different terminology. All thing about it is that competitions are a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
But that it was the same.
Wow. Okay, man.
All right. So when you're in training camp, like how much do they put on you? I mean, like, hey, this week we're gonna do 10 new plays, or is it like how's that work? You have meetings and
I mean we can do plays like every week, you know, something that somebody wants to try out, you know what I mean? It's kind of things like that.
So you have meetings and you go in there and, hey, this week we're going to do this. And
yeah, pretty much.
The scouting is incredible, huh?
It is.
They know everything about everybody.
Everything everybody, they watch. like everything you do.
And what kind of advice would you have for a young offensive lineman coming up, you know, trying to get into college? Like, what kind of things would you tell them to work on? What, you know, weight room, footwork, things like that, attitude?
No, I would say football always take care of itself. Mm-hmm. I'm focused on telling a young kid right now, and these day and age, is stuff after schoolwork, in grades first, and then we can go to football.
Yeah,
because all of God, family, and football. You know, okay. If I was a category, you got to put God first in everything mm-hmm. you do, and have him worry about schoolwork first. Did they work it out? Now, working out now, you know, like ready, mm-hmm. rested, staying in shape. Doing jump rows, ladder drill, boxing helps out for your head weight, footwork, you know, doing little back drills mm-hmm. to get better, and that's how you become a great offensive lineman. It's a technique driven position.
Yeah,
it's what it is.
Did you play any other sport in high school?
I played basketball.
Basketball.
I ran a track. I ran a 200.
200.
I died,
but I ran it. Hey, we ain't never run 200 anything.
200. Hey, 200. Oh, man. But I died, though.
Wow. I got tired watching the 200.
Shoot. All right, that's what I was like 305.
Wow.
I can run. Come on.
200.
That's what my mom played. She played basketball, too. She didn't go pro, but she don't play. She was like a sprinter.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you shot put. You didn't do any shot put.
I did. Oh. I did shot put, too. I won state 3 years in a row.
By the way,
yeah.
So you ran track. That's where that was your pro day. You ran a 5.2, right?
5.1.
5.1.
Yeah.
Man, that's a movie for a whole lot.
Right,
300 pounds.
Yeah, you don't need three people behind you. I'm 5.1 coming at
you. Running.
Where they train you? Because everybody trains before the combine.
I would train it down in Marietta,
in Georgia.
I was in Georgia. Oh,
wow. Okay. Was it inside?
I was inside. Okay. In indoor, it was cold every morning. God, that indoor was cold. Man, I said, man, turn the heat on. He said, you'll be okay. You'll be all right. We out there in the heat. Remember Kubla. He played for Evan Kubla. He played for the Panthers now. Played guard. He was like, man, it's so cold. We were like, bro, look, let's warm up right by each other so we can
get that body heat.
Get that body heat, bro. Get that body heat, bro.
Hey, share the body
heat. Hey, man, I'm trying to tell you. Those were hard days. But when it got hot for real.
Tell you that. Stay away from me now.
No, man, hey, man. Yeah.
Dude, man, it's a big facility.
Yeah, it's pretty huge, though. We're in your facility, but it was super cold that day. Especially like working out during January, February. Pushing out south during that time because it don't warm up until March.
Oh, yeah. So now, when you came to San Diego first, you started seeing the sights and everything, like the beaches and everything. Like, how different was that from the swamps of LSU and Louisiana?
It was okay. You know,
no alligators.
Oh, man. Well, that's true. Y'all have sharks, though.
Yeah.
I see the shark attacks, you know. It's shark week in August. So I'm good. I'm not going out there. You know, coming here was kind of like a culture shock for me. Uh-huh. You know, see how people are here. Man, when I first got here, now, it was like, for me, it was like, are people nice here or not? You know, can't tell. I mean, some people were kind of rude to me a little bit. Yeah. Is this how West Coast is? Oh. But then I started meeting other people like in the city. They kind of feel like who I was. It's all different than Hello, he's a ball player. Okay. We got you him a little bit different than everybody else. I mean, then it kind of like felt for the place where everybody started liking me and stuff. So it was great.
So, like, the beaches in San Diego is much different than the beach in Alabama.
I mean, the beach in here is cold. The water's cold for me. We're about the Pacific. Beach at home, like Gulf of Alabama now. I've been out there, and the beach is warm.
The water's warm.
And we got Nike.
White sand.
You know.
And then white sand beaches.
White sand beaches, pretty.
Yeah.
So you'll love it down there.
Do some fishing?
I try to go deep sea fishing, but see too many videos. I'll pass.
Yeah, Shark Week will get you, man. That'll change your life right there.
Yeah, Shark Week will change your life. For real.
So now, let's take us back to when you're in Alabama and Nick Saban, like you know, he doesn't seem like he's a rah-rah guy, but he's intense, right? I mean, what's a halftime speech or a pregame speech with this guy?
You know, first of all, come say my ass again. You know, tells his players on. There's no I in team, but there's an I in win. That's for each individual to do the job to the best of their ability. And that means that everybody has to be accountable, like for their actions. And that's how you look at it. You know, we go in there and do a job at 18 years old, 19 years old. We go in there and try to fight for get a starting job on the teams or O-line or D-line or whatever. But he tells us that you have to go in there with a clear mindset, be humble, and go get it. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did. We bought in Big Red. Even if we didn't have players on our team that were not great, they bought in Big Red, so they became great players.
Right. Wow, so he's like...
mindset.
He's an inspirational guy, but not a rah-rah guy.
No, definitely not. So he's more of deep trying to buy into what he wants you to do.
Hey, can you talk a little bit about your strength coach?
Yeah! Don't talk about it! Hey, Coach,
right there.
That guy's on caffeine like no other. He gets a smoothie key with extra caffeine, double strawberry Caribbean way.
He's got to make his own coffee brand.
Strawberry, it's like a smoothie key. Smoothie key. We'll have one out here, though. It's kind of like double juice.
Yeah.
Double juice. It's kind of same the off brand. But he coming out with caffeine, smoothie key, all that caffeine, man. He ready to go. He rolling.
Hey, yo!
Let's go! I'll be like, God, it's like 6 in the morning. Some of you waking up this morning. He said, if you're waking up, man, you lost half the battle, man. Come on now. Let's go.
So, intense session.
It's a intense workout. Man. Yeah, let's go. Hit it, let's go. Yeah, I'm fine. Whoa, man, calm down. It's all big contagious. Everybody wanted to get hype. Everybody was like happy for practice. It started spreading around like wildfire.
Man. Everyone imitates him.
Huh?
Everyone on the team can imitate him.
Everybody imitates him. Everybody imitates
him. So like O line coach, do you have the same one the whole time?
I had Joe Pedry. Joe Pedry. Then I had Jeff Stalin.
Who's at Miami?
He's at Miami with Joe Panaggio. Okay. He was at Alabama as well. And he even goes to the Eagles. He's been an offensive line coach.
Oh, wow.
So for the Eagles now.
Yeah. So he's contributed a lot to your talents.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Was he a rah-rah guy or he's a
Stalin was a rah-rah guy. Uh-huh. You would get in your face and you would not like it, but he would say you have to like it.
Right.
And now I was like, nah, I ain't that guy. I ain't that guy, because I'll get my time done.
Wow.
I'll get it done.
Yeah, he ain't like Cochran, though, right?
Nah.
No one's like him, though, right?
I haven't had a guy come close yet. Wow. Not at all.
Wow. Man, intense. But he gets the job done.
Exactly. So, what did you get your degree in?
General health.
Oh, okay.
I was doing nursing for a little bit, but then I had to change it.
I don't know how you can do that with football and everything. It's just
too much time. And I couldn't do it, so I had to change my major. So eventually, I'm gonna go back when football is a little bit over.
So what do you think about life after football in about 10, 15 years when you're done playing the O line and dominating in the NFL?
It's a little far ahead, but I mean.
You know, some guys get into stuff in the off season. You know, they have all these little business ventures and things like that.
Right now, I'm trying to save everything I have right now.
Smart man.
You know, I know a lot of people out there doing these big investments at a young age, trying to get rich quick schemes and all that. I'll pass all that.
Yeah,
I work too hard to give it away. So yeah. Else, you know? So I'm just trying to wait, you know, save everything I have, just working hard and focus on football, trying to get my mind right for the season. And just be humble and
staying in the community. I know I work out at Montgomery High School in San Diego, and I remember you came down there last year, talked to our kids. Our kids still talk about
that. Oh, yeah.
That was a big moment for them. Down there, not too many people come down there, you know, from the Chargers or anything like that to go talk to the kids.
Right.
And just for you to come down there, that was huge. So, you know,
we really appreciate, you know, really appreciate you coming down there and doing that. Oh,
oh no, go ahead. So, I want to get back to the to Nick Saban and that, you know, he came from the Miami Dolphins right before he got there, or was right. It LSU?
He was at LSU first, and then he ended up going to Miami Dolphins coached there for a couple of years.
So in your recruiting process, I mean, only trips to LSU and Auburn and Alabama. Yeah. There was multiple trips you turned down, right?
Yeah, I had coaches that I turned down because they were like, look, you either come here or there. And I had to make a choice. And I was like, all right, well, I'm just coming to Bama, you know. Right. But, I mean, I did take a few visits. But I just kind of fell in love with the school.
Yeah. You know? Now, DJ, we have this is our Coach Rowe Player of the Week right here, Micah Edwards, back in there. And now we have offensive lineman for Lincoln High School. We play center and guard as Andrew Sachet. And you guys have some questions for DJ? Don't be shy, my man. You're all lineman, man. This guy's got a wealth of knowledge right here.
Yeah. How is college in Alabama?
I mean, it's awesome experience. You can go anywhere you want to go, man. I can't recruit you.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, if you want to win a championship, you know where to go. They'll lead you there. But I mean, going to Alabama and going to campus. The campus is amazing. Facilities are amazing. The lunch area is amazing too because they have food for us. Like you give a 24-hour I'm on nutritionist.
Yeah.
She's always texting you, calling your phones, checking on you, seeing if you're okay and everything like that.
Yeah, because people were telling me a lot they take good care of the people who go to Alabama.
Yeah, your players they take care of every athlete on campus. From the coaches on down.
Yeah.
I mean, even though they're athletes no more, but, they take care of everybody. Yeah. But you'll love that. If you went there for a visit, you enjoy it. You have a good time out there. Knowing the coaches, knowing the fans, the biggest thing about Alabama is the student fan base. Mm-hmm. You see your campus man speak to you, they call you by name. Okay. And they don't even have to know who you are, but they call you by name. Hey, what's up, DJ? out of blue. He'd be like, oh, how you know me? But you got to think about it. We all play football. So,
yeah.
I can't not. Yeah. But if you go there, you'll love. You have a great time. The academic things, the academic process is great, too. So you'll graduate on time, trust me. Right.
You graduate like 3.5 years, you said?
3.5.
Wow. That's getting after it.
Man. Yeah. Got to.
Yeah.
You can have time because the freshman, we all want to go out, party, have a great time. I mean, you had those times, but man, my main thing for me was like trying to get great. Man, don't get me wrong, I did have a good time.
Yeah.
But I still got after that school work.
Where are you originally from?
I'm New Orleans.
New Orleans.
Yeah. Tough streets of New Orleans.
Yeah, Night War.
Night War.
He's down.
That sounds scary. Like, why do they call it war? A war. Prison war.
I mean, everybody from different areas. So we got 9-1, 8-1, 3-1, 4-1. It's all, everything's different, you know? Yeah.
So Ward is a neighborhood.
Basically, block, whatever.
Yeah. Wow. We have blocks out here. Yeah. Somebody said, hey, we moved to the 5th Ward. I'm like, no. Kidding me? A Ward? No way. But, Andrew, any more questions for the big man here?
Let me get shy.
My man ran for 169 yards and a touchdown.
Really?
And my man was over here handing out pancakes that was going out of style.
Cute,
butter. Yeah. They beat a North County team, which is North County is supposed to always beat up on,
right.
The city teams.
But right.
The Hive over here, beat them 2016. It was a big game. So, these two cats here, balled out after all.
22 trap, favorite play.
Yeah,
22 trap. He's pulling it. Man,
22 trap.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah.
He said his favorite play is any play where he goes one-on-one with anybody.
Yeah.
It shows who's the big dog.
Yeah.
Me or you.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, I also play defense, too, because they also double-team me a lot.
See, yeah, that's a good thing. They can't get to your back. That's a good thing. You're a big guy.
Yeah.
Team.
Yeah, got to hold the point.
Did you play any other sport?
I'm thinking about playing basketball this year, but I don't know.
You play basketball. Good footwork, I'm telling you. I mean, if you can play basketball, the more you can do it, the better.
It's about
cardio, because usually play ball, we just kind of sit around for next season. You got to be active, man.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I'm talking about my dad.
Go play basketball, man. Go do track, you know. Yeah. You try to stay active.
Always get people in the 200.
Go out there.
Michael, what about you? You play any other sports?
Thinking about running track this year.
Track? Okay.
Yeah. Nice.
You want track?
Yeah.
I was just here with his mom earlier. She was telling about how she, they call it skirts.
Yeah.
Track star. I was like, man. She was a beast back in the day.
Yeah. It was skirts.
I don't think you say boat will. Put a red wall. So you went through it early.
Oh man, that's crazy.
Oh man, she told me, I said, okay, your son gotta be a running back. So she's like, yeah, he fast. I just like, yes sir. I believe it. They were saying, I'm like, okay, he kind of like Reggie Bush, huh? Fast like that?
Yeah.
Then Brett likes me waving in the wind.
Shoot.
So on defense, man, how did you break that double team up, man? It's just easy, right?
Man, I double team. Man, I got pictures from high school, man. It's on my Instagram, though.
Okay.
But man, I was 6'5". I played a game barefooted for a sack. Yeah. Freshman,
right here.
I had tennis shoes all the time playing. I couldn't get pushed back. So I said, all right, cool, be smart. So I hit up. Take my socks off and planted my toes in the ground and I teed off. But yeah, think about these kids now, they're not that big. They're about like 6'3", 6'2".
Oh yeah, not very big.
Like 260. You know, I'm at 260 pounds. I'm like, oh, I got this. And I was just pushing around. Then I finally got cleats around week 3 or whatever.
Week 3 got cleats.
Got cleats. Man, how does that piece of this feel? That's when everything changed my life. I'm trying to move real now.
Please.
Yeah.
Disagree, man. What size is them puppy?
What's that, 20?
What?
Yeah.
I need to see the guy with big shoes.
Man, he got big socks, man. Big shoes. Slow it. Ladies out there.
Y'all woke up right now.
Oh, man.
So you got your son out here?
He's actually at Belmar now.
Oh, he is?
Okay. He's down there with his mom and everything.
Nice.
Yeah,
he's like, what, 5? Or?
He's like, he's like 4.
4.
Or he was just here about 2 weeks ago.
How's he like out here?
He loves it. He wants to go to Disneyland all the time. Disneyland, I'm like, Disneyland, I said, it's like 2 hours away, man. Like, I said, we go to Legoland.
Cheese.
That's for his spot down. I said, niggas, they both of them. He go there and play the game all day. I sit there, I'm like, man, I'm going to sleep, man. I'm moving.
You get a bigger workout chasing around that place.
Well, I ain't have to chase too far. I mean, he kind of went game by game.
Is football the only sport you played?
I played a little bit of basketball.
You did?
Yeah, I got cut my ooh, senior year.
What?
Yeah, my coach said, because I had to go on visits to colleges, so I would travel. And we had games. We had, what, 2 games during the week, and I missed one of them. But I was like, coach, like, you knew I had. I told him ahead of time, like, you know that I have a job to do. I have to go to college, you know. To take his visits, he got mad. He's like, "Well, you're not on the team." I would have fought that. I told my coach, or my football coach, and I talked to the principal. Like, he can't keep on the team because I ain't doing no wrong, you know. And so I didn't stay on the team, but I didn't really get to a playing time. But then I did. So I was like, okay.
So were you a point guard or?
I was actually power forward for a minute. Because Julio Jones, Julio Jones played together. He was center. And I was the power four. I'm like, well, who's gonna have more hops than me? So I feel it. You know, I didn't forget. I had shoulder surgery or whatever. Going to high school playing that same year as him. Mm-hmm. And I see Demarcus Cousins. He played at LaFleur High School down in Mobile. So Julio sees a rebound. They shot a rebound. our team had shot it, right? Mm-hmm. They missed it. Julio Jones and DeMarcus Cousins were going off for a rebound.
Wow.
So, let me tell you what Jones did. Jones got crazy ups. He takes the ball out of his hand, cocks it back on top of and booms on top of
him.
Oh. Around. I was like, oh my God. Everybody left the gym. Nobody knew he could jump that high. I'm talking about literally everybody left the gym. Everybody had it took about 20 or 30 minutes for everybody to get back in the gym. Nobody ever seen it.
Crazy.
So those you three cats on the same court?
Same court. One time. He can shoot I will tell you one thing. He can't ball. He ball on that court now. You know.
So your job was rebounds and
I was rebounding. I mean I get the little crash off the glass. You know. I ain't too fancy. I'm not saying they can check the free throw level. So I can make my free throws though.
You know, free throws and shot, right?
Free throws.
Oh. So when you're on off season, basketball
in your high. I take a little hooping session every now and then. I got a little bitch league basketball. It's okay.
And I know I follow you on Snapchat. You know, I got your account. you know what I'm saying. You know, I know you got your little watch collection and stuff. What is your hobbies?
I mean, I got a brand. I'm a little brand too. Yeah. DVD. Like Don't Be Denied. I got a little Warrior watches there. Yeah. You know, so.
The plug, man.
Yeah.
That's it. What can you find? I mean, a guy with a low budget that I have, where can we find his watches?
I mean, you can go to the jewelry store downtown. I got to get a label because I'm not the only one that's doing it for me. Doing it because I'm fucking with football, so I can't take it every day.
I know. Okay. Yeah. So he shared it with me on Snapchat, so okay. I'll get you the information and. I help you push these watches out, man.
Oh, you're saying?
I'm a marketing director over here.
Okay.
I do a lot of that little marketing director, man. I'm a watch fiend too, so I need to go pick that.
Okay. Yeah, for one though. Yeah, for
one. We need to get in the gym to work.
Yeah, that's
nice. I'm gonna get in the weight room. We gotta get in the weight room to wear that thing like
your last. No. Well, we have like wear watches. Then we got like exclusive watches, like for. Because the whole thing is about being a business warrior.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, today, I'm a radio warrior. Because I'm on a talk show, you know, talking about football and everything, you know what I mean? Yeah. So, it's about being a dad warrior, mom warrior, you know, because every day we are warrior at something. Mm-hmm. That's how I look at it. It's about having that mindset.
Wow. Well, DJ, man, I really appreciate you coming out here. It was incredible talking to you.
Amazing.
And I have my guys from Lincoln over here that, Micah Edwards, our player of the week.
Yeah, make sure you follow him.
Oh, yeah.
And, my man Harvey Boy, 45 Iggy. This is the Crossroads Show on KBLKRadio.com. See you next week.